I will be speaking about three state-run archives in Kathmandu, the National Archives in Maitigarh, the Foreign Ministry Archives also in Maitigarh, and the Military Archives in Tripureshwar. I will be concentrating on their unpublished, handwritten collection of historical documents in the Nepali language. I will not be discussing their library or their collection of sources in Nepal Bhasa or Tibetan scripts because I don't read these and I'm not the person to be speaking about these. Hopefully we can have another discussion on private archives and archives in other languages of Nepal some other time. I will begin with the archive that is least familiar to me, the military archives. The military archive contains documents mainly from the Kamandari Kitab Khana. For anyone studying Nepal's wars with Tibet or British India, or Nepal's assistance during the Indian mutiny, or the military aid mobilized by Nepal during the two world wars, would find this archive very useful. The military archives also preserves records related to various hunting expeditions, those related to refugees coming from Burma to Nepal, visits by various heads of states from the early Rana period onwards, documents related to the arsenal, to manufacture, import and export of guns and ammunition before the 1950s, and to various war-related expenditures, etc. In order to access the military archives, you need your citizenship certificate proving that you are a Nepali and a letter explaining your purpose. It also helps if you call in advance and let them know what you want to study. Based on whatever little experience I've had at the military archives, I believe there is some gatekeeping, but if you can explain your research queries well enough, you are given access. The next is the National Archives. The National Archives in Maitigarh is perhaps the largest in terms of the number and variety of its collections. It comprises the Kumaritsu documents, microfilms of Bhuti documents, inscriptions from the Liechty period onwards, various manuscripts on Dharma Shastras, Jyotish Shastras, Hindu rites and rituals, Tibetan manuscripts, historical letters or the Aitihasik Chichi Patra Samara from the pre-Dhamma Bahadur and Dhamma Bahadur periods. But how do you know what, where to look and how to look at the National Archives? Unlike many libraries or archives, you will not find an online catalogue of their holdings, but the director, Saumagya Pradhananga, has informed us that they are in the process of preparing one. If you are looking for a particular document, you will be directed to a list like this or to typed ledgers. Like this. This is the type ledger from the Kumaritsuk, and this is the Aitihasik Chichi Patra Ko type ledger. So, for example, if you're looking at something, you're looking for something on industrialization, early industrialization. When you make inquiries with the staff there, you will be told that you need to go through the typed ledger of the Kumaritsuk documents. And so you'll have to go through each entry, page by page, one entry at a time, until you find what you're looking for. For example, I was looking at Udyog Parishad, so serial number 210 is the Udyog Parishad. And then you give them this number, you fill a small, you fill a form and you pay a small fees and the POCA will be brought to you. These are the quotas. Now, they contain all these handwritten documents. Now, reading the quotas and making sense of them is another story. Now, this is the National Archives. It is not Kathmandu centric. It has unpublished handwritten documents, not just from Kathmandu, Patan or Bhaktapur, but from, and I will name them one by one, Doryaldura, Doti, Bajra, Assam, Bajan, Gumla, Muku, Kalipur, Jajapur, Surke, Doile, Solyan, Rolpa, Dan, Yuchan, Mustang, Magdi, Bagun, Parvat, Arkanhati, Gulmi, Palpa, Kapilvastu, Tanau, Longjung, Siangda, Muapur, Prasua, Dolakha, Udaipur, Bhojpur, and Panchthar. I may have missed others. Let us look at some of the examples from Palpa. Sorry, I just picked Palpa randomly. Some examples from the records in the possession of the district office Palpa that are with the National Archives. For example, a document from 1959 AD relating to the construction of a motorable road in Palpa. Or another document from 1959 AD again for providing telephone connections and furniture to the port in Palpa. Or another document from 1963 AD related to the construction of a Mohan Kanya school in Palpa. Now these three examples are recent, from recent history, mostly from the Panchayat period, and they are state related. Most documents under the possession of all the three archives, the National Archives, the Military Archives and the Foreign Ministry Archives, come from the state's administrative units such as the District Revenue Office, the district court or sometimes the chula bada of that particular area. However, this does not mean that one can only write a state-centered or a Kathmandu-centered history. There are sources at the National Archives that can contribute to a more people-centered history or histories from across the nation. For example, from the same district office in Palpa, we also have the following sources. A charter from 1935 AD under the signature of the Prime Minister regarding women under 45 applying permit to go to India to be examined. Or another one from 1934 AD addressed to the officials concerned to let Indians live in the Tarai if they have been residing there for a long time. Another one from 1935 AD again, prescribing minimal expenses in operating marriages, birth-related rituals, etc. among the Miawar community. Another one from 1933 in respect of marriage banning child marriage and determining the marriageable age for each caste and subcaste. So there are many such examples, many such documents. On slavery, for example, there are documents from Doti, Jumla and Parvat regarding the supply of slaves, the supply of female slaves, and on the prohibition on sales of children. Similarly, there are documents on labor, labor relations, forced labor, labor exemptions, complaints of labor exploitation, and on the sales and transport and exploitation of women for the palaces in Kathmandu from various districts such as Parvat, Dang and Kalikot. There are many Bhuti-related documents from all over the country that are not only informative in terms of Bhuti assets, but also speak of temple rituals, management and operation, the symbiosis between religions, the role of Bhutis in public works such as rest houses, bridges, taps, and their roles in the care and conservation of forests, flora, fauna, and the relation between, of course, the Bhuti and the state. Then there are folk tales, there are devotional songs, in languages such as Nepal Bhasha, as well as translations of Hindu scriptures into Nepal Bhasha. There are documents that would augment the existing historiography of caste relations in Nepal. For example, documents that illuminate perceptions surrounding caste roles, that discuss the role of various caste groups in temples, public rituals, community practices, documents that speak of caste-related harmony and discord are also available. Similarly, there seem to be a good amount of documents on bazaars and merchants, for example, Palpa Bazaar, documents from Palpa Bazaar, Khalanga Bazaar, Bagloom Bazaar, trading post in Mustang. There is also a good amount of documents on local ways of organizing, controlling, distributing from religious institutions, from trading groups, from various castes, and from local resources, including flora, fauna, water bodies, agricultural lands in an era before so-called democracy. So on the one hand, we have all these treasures at the National Archives, all these primary sources that have not been studied enough. But then on the other hand, how much of Nepali history that has been written so far has been based on such unpublished sources? To answer this, I checked some of the literature referred to in Yogesh Raj and Prakash Watta's History, Education and Research in Nepal, published in 2014 by Martin Zagari. If you read that booklet, you will realize that not all of the history writing in Nepal is state-centered. There have been attempts, recent attempts, to decenter history writing. For example, in the works of Indira Joshi, Arjun Babu Mabuhang and Bharat Thunghang, Gopal Bhatt Bhattrai, Mahesh Chaudhary, Kansa Bania, C.K. Rao, Kamal Jangai, Indradev Rai, or Prem Shanti Tuladhar, among others. But to go back to my question, how much of what is being written is based on unpublished archival sources? Not much. For example, according to the reference section of Indira Joshi's Nepali Itihas Ka Bigvir, Pakshaharu, or Gopal Bhatt Bhattrai's Bhankuta Gaura Ko Itihas, or Mahesh Chaudhary's Nepal Ko Tarai Tatha Yaska Bhumi Kudra. These studies are mostly based on interviews and on secondary literature. Scholarship of Dalits and Janjatis is mostly ethnographic. There are exceptions such as Imam Singh Chemjong's Kirat Itihas of Sanskriti, and Arjun Babu Mabuhang and Bharat Thunghang's Hodson Pandu Bhima Gurtha Khambuan Nibuan Yuga, which engage both in primary and secondary sources, but with Arjun Babu Mabuhang and Thunghang's book, it is an interesting narration of the Kirat history and on Gurtha Khambuan Nibuan war based on the Hodson papers. There is also Ghanashyam Bhattrai's Birgat Ko Aitihasik Ruprekha, which has very interesting aspects of Birgams as an entry point to Nepal and as a trade and administrative unit from the 19th to the mid-20th century. However, this also contains a few documents from the military archives, but it's annexed to the annex and doesn't find a place in the main text. Then there are others such as C.K. Rao's Madheska Itihas or Vasudev Lal Das's The Senas of Makbanpur, which rely not only on primary and secondary sources, but on inscriptions, Hindu scriptures, genealogies, even numismatics, leading some of these works to become more like a compilation of all kinds of sources instead of history writing itself. Now, according to the National Archives, it received a total of 362 visitors last year. Not all of these visitors were researchers. Many were people looking for documents for pending legal cases for the Bhumi Sudhar documents, and there were students seeking date conversions, etc. The number of researchers was very low, just 7 to 10. The military archives is even more dismal. In fact, somebody from the military archives wanted to know how to make it more accessible and user-friendly. If we could get some suggestions from the audience, that would be great. But to get back to the point I was trying to make, although there is a movement away from state-centered history to more social-cultural histories within the university and the non-university arenas, as Raj and Mata write in their book, there is very little engagement with archival sources, particularly with unpublished sources. There is also very little exchange, communication and dialogue between unpublished archives and other kinds of archives, such as published archives or visual archives or oral history. In terms of, now the Foreign Ministry Archives, in terms of access, the Foreign Ministry Archives is even more dismal than the Military Archives, because the Foreign Ministry Archives is under the Foreign Ministry. It is not the property of the National Archives, although it is located at the National Archives. If you're a citizen of Nepal, you are given access to the Foreign Ministry Archives, provided you manage to enter Singhadarbar, reach the Foreign Ministry, get somebody in the Foreign Ministry to write you a letter. And even then, you are only given access to whatever 1, 2, 3 documents that you list in your letter. You can't access everything that they have, unlike the National Archives. The Foreign Ministry Archives consists of Sandhi Patras, Chichi Patras, Bhagani Sanad, Vishape, Ikshape, etc. and is very, very interesting for people wanting to study early 20th century Nepal. Those documents up to 1960 are open. From 1960 onwards, they are closed. There are many, many pokas on Nepal-Tibet relations, so many that you could spend an entire life just looking at Nepal-Tibet trade relations. There are also documents from the Sri Chandra, Biduli, Bhatti, Adda, the Mohan Akashwani, the Dursing Mata Tirtha Ropeway, the Gautar Airport, and an entire early history of aviation that is yet to be written. Or there are documents on Nepal's technology imports through British India for its industrialization, or documents on early cinema, or documents on Nepal-India border demarcation, border dispute, border transgressions, etc. But before you get lost in this labyrinth, how do you know what's there in the Foreign Ministry Archives? Is there an archive online catalog? No, there isn't. What you do is you go through a four series source manual edited by Safale or Matthias, published by the National History Guide Committee in 1988. This source manual was compiled in 1988, and in 2019 it doesn't appear very accurate. For example, I was looking for documents on telephones, and I first checked the Kumari Tok documents, found a few things on the Prime Minister's telephone exchanges, but that was not enough to write a paper. So I went to the military archives, I didn't find anything there, and then someday I was just browsing through Safale or Matthias source manual and came across something that mentions telephones. It says a ledger with a count of the telephones made from 1915 something. And it mentioned the serial number 57. Unfortunately, at the Foreign Ministry Archive, they have not yet been able to find serial number 57. Not because it doesn't exist, but because the handwritten ledger prepared by the Foreign Ministry after the 2015 earthquake, when everything fell and the pokas had to be rearranged, that number does not match with the number mentioned by Safale or Matthias. So it can get a little confusing and disappointing at times. But to get an idea of what each of these archives, each of the three state-run archives, the military archives, the national archives, and the foreign ministry archives contain, I think it is best to begin by browsing Safale or Matthias' source manual. I will conclude with an email I received from someone who has been working on telephones and telegraphs in British India. He wrote that while he was working on telegraph and post office files at the British Library in London, all of a sudden short notes on telephones started popping up, and he was curious and he found them interesting, and he pursued them while he was researching for something else. So this email confirmed my suspicion that archival research can be a baffling maze of unanticipated, sometimes even serendipitous findings. Serendipity is not a research method, of course, but if you're working at one of the state-run archives in Nepal, most of your research will probably initially be serendipitous. How you convert such a beginning into a methodical book or a research paper will depend on how willing you are to make n number of visits to these labyrinth-like archives. Thank you.